fighting the Taliban's war against women. This week on Firing Line.
The day that Kabul fell, it was the darkest days of my life.
Scenes of desperation from Kabul 2 years ago. With the U.S. withdrawal in its final stages, the Taliban gained control of Afghanistan and broke its promises.
I am particularly concerned by accounts of mounting human rights violations against the women and girls of Afghanistan who fear a return to the darkest days.
Afghanistan is now the most repressive country in the world for women and girls, according to the UN. School is banned after sixth grade. Most work isn't allowed. Even going to the gym and parks is forbidden.
There was an education for everyone. It is not only limited to boys or to certain families and certain ethnic groups, and we had freedom of speech.
Afghan tech entrepreneur Roya Mahboob knew and lived the promise of progress in Afghanistan. In 2010, she became the country's first female tech CEO, then was named one of the world's most influential people by Time magazine.
Team Afghanistan.
Mahboob also created the Afghan Girls Robotics Team that competed around the world.
These young people have a dream, big dreams. If a young girl can build a ventilator, if a young girl can build a drone, because you give the equal access, anyone can do it.
With no signs of the Taliban relenting, and tens of thousands of Afghans who aided the U.S. mission in Afghanistan left behind, what does Roya Mahboob say now?
Firing Line with Margaret Hoover is made possible in part by Robert Granieri, Vanessa and Henry Cornell, the Fairweather Foundation, the Tepper Foundation, the Asness Family Foundation, the McKenna Family Foundation, Charles R. Schwab, and by the Roslyn P. Walter Foundation and Damon Button. Corporate funding is provided by Stevens, Inc.
Roya Mahboob, welcome to Firing Line.
Thank you for having me here.
It's been 2 years since the fall of Afghanistan to the Taliban, but I want to take you back to the first time that the Taliban took over Afghanistan in the 1990s when you were an eight-year-old girl. What was it like living in Afghanistan in the 1990s?
I mean, at that time, obviously, situation was different. And I just remembering the day that the Taliban took over the city. They came to all the houses and they collected the TVs and books. And from the window of my house, I just see that they turn everything's in the fire. And I see the ideas, the freedom is turned to the ash. And it's made me angry. But then we left Afghanistan.
You left with your family
in
1996 and you went to Iran. Tell me about what happened with your baby sister that led your family to decide to flee to Iran.
My youngest sister was only 8 months and my brothers and my father were not in the city. So they went for the work. And my mother was not allowed to take the baby to the doctors because there was no any male guardian. Again, Taliban wouldn't allow it. And that night, my mom had to spend the night with my sister. And she knows that she cannot do anything to save her. And the next morning, we lost her. And I think that's it's always remind with me, just because we were a woman, we couldn't save her. So after that, my parents decided to leave and go to Iran.
You spent the next several years growing up in Iran, and you returned to Afghanistan in 2003. After the US-led invasion toppled the Taliban regime, you described those years and the years that followed as golden years for Afghanistan. Why were they the golden years?
Well, in the context of the history of Afghanistan, that was the only era that democracy is flourished. There was an education for everyone. It wasn't, is not only limited to boys or to certain families and certain ethnic groups. And we had freedom of speech. And, I want to tell my stories. When we return back to Afghanistan, in 2003, there was an Indian cafe that was opened up in Herat. And, people talk about this magic box that get connected you to the people and to outside world. And you find any information you want. And I was insisted to go to that Indian cafe. And the first time I saw this magic box. And I think that that moment I decided to make Determined the technology really center of my career. There was so many opportunities at the time. And if you were smart and you wanted to take that advantage, you could grow. And with that amazing support that we got from the US and United States and their allies, is the door of opportunity was open up, not only for me, but for millions of the women and children in Afghanistan.
You earned a computer science degree from Herat University. You became Afghanistan's first female tech CEO, where you had to manage many male Afghan colleagues who were older than you. Did you observe attitudes of Afghan men changing and adopting to the new reality of women being empowered in the workforce in Afghanistan?
I think being tech female CEOs anywhere in part of the world, you will face with some challenges, but working in Afghanistan was more challenging and had more obstacles. But those obstacles and challenges made me who I am today. In many cases, at the beginning, they feel that they should not pay you equal as your male colleagues. They don't take you serious as an engineer. At my time, I was only one of a few women who work in tech. And it's difficult when you will be one of a few because they are trying to take you down because they don't like the changes because the society is not ready for that change. When you wanted to bring the change in a society, you have to create more role models. And when we started Digital Citizen Fund, I think it was the start of the seeing the changes because we help thousands of the women learn about technology.
Tell me about Digital Citizen Fund.
Digital Citizen Fund is a nonprofit organization that I started when I left Afghanistan with a goal that technology is an accessible option for everyone, but especially for the women in conservative societies. And the idea was that these young women, they learn about basic things about the computer, like I learned. And I'm teaching them about social media, coding, and financial literacy, and as well robotics. And we helped 17,000 of the girls to our program. We built 13 technology centers, 11 public high schools, and 2 individual STEM innovation centers in Kabul and Herat. We also helped hundreds of these women to start their own startups. The young generation of Afghanistan has always given me hope because they were resilient, they were courage, and they were determined to be somehow to be part of their communities. They were very active. If you go to the every communities, you see that these young people have a dream, big dreams. Talking with my young students, they say they're talking to how to go to the Mars and how to, becoming the next president. They wants to be minister. They wants all of them had big ambitions.
You launched the Afghan Girls Robotics Team in 2017, which competes in robotic competitions around the world. What message did it send to create this group of women to compete nationally?
We wanted to send a message if a woman in Afghanistan can do, any woman can do in any part of the world. And when First Global contacted me to building this Afghan Dreamers, I said, I'm not sure if I can find the teenager with the age groups in Afghanistan because robotics is very new. And they told me either find a team or build a team. And I decided to build a team. And we took an exam and we selected 60 for first competition. And when they won the silver medal and they returned back, the community was divided. Some was very conservative and they were not happy that girls traveling with the male guardian, and were not happy that we took the girls out, and because the girls give handshake and these pictures come out, so we're very angry. But then other group of the Heratic community was very supportive. They came in actually with some of the mullahs to the airport to just show that they are supporting this group and they support innovation, they support creativity. And at that moment, as I say, there is light in the darkness, and dear determination and hope changed the Afghan community, and it was a victory for us.
What has happened with the Afghan National Girls Robotics Team since the fall of Kabul and the takeover by the Taliban in 2021?
A group of them were in Kabul and they were competing. It was in the middle of the competition of First Global that the Kabul fell. And we didn't know what to do. And thanks to the Qatari government at the time, we could evacuate them and relocated them to Qatar. And, you know, we are very proud because this year we had 18 students who accepted at universities, most of the universities in the United States, UK and Canada. They got full funding scholarships and we were really proud of them.
I want to talk more about what's happened to women and girls in Afghanistan since the fall of Kabul. But first, I want to ask you about your own experience during the evacuation. How was your family's experience?
I mean, the day that Kabul fell, it was the darkest days of my life. And we just failed to protect the freedom and democracy that for 20 years changed our life. We took it for granted, but we couldn't protect it and fight for it. So that day I was realizing that. And I was hard to see that the younger generation were not gonna have the same freedom that I had and many of my generation and same opportunities that we had. But at that point, it was my darkest time. And I was just in shock like many others when we heard that President Ghani escaped. I just couldn't believe it because I always admired him and his courage. And we feel all of this speeches is true. We thought at the time it's true and he's the leader who's gonna protect the country.
Did you feel betrayed by him?
We feel betrayed by him and many other politicians at the time. We felt it was horrible. It was disheartening to see it. He left it before anyone else leave. At the same time, my team and my parents were in the airport and airport was a chaos because after his escape, flight couldn't happen. And I had 10 young girls in an apartment. Mm-hmm. And everybody knows that they are robotic team members. And I didn't know how to have a protection for them. I'm with my old parents that they were there. There was only my father was the only man. The rest were female. So
how did they evacuate? How did they escape?
Qatari government at the time, they are the only one who respond to our text and they give them, they evacuated the team. But you know, we have thousands of students. We had thousands of the employees. We did as much as we could, but obviously it wasn't feasible to take everyone out of the country.
How many of your employees and students remain in Afghanistan now?
Thousands of our students still are in Afghanistan. We couldn't do, unfortunately, anything for them.
Amnesty International describes, quote, widespread and systemic subjugation of girls and women, including restrictions on education, work, and movement. There are allegations of torture and imprisonment and forced marriage for women. How has life changed for women in Afghanistan in the past 2 years?
Life's completely changed. Many of them go to the university and the schools and they had education, they had dream of a better future, all of them gone. Since Taliban took over the country, they systematically dismissed all like institution that was set up to support women. Minister for Women Affairs was canceled. The Human Rights Commission was canceled. All the shelters and organizations who support for women rights and helping the women empowerment and gender-based violence, they're all gone. And today, still after 2 years, the school are remain closed. Women cannot travel without the male guardians. And based on the report of UN, 9 out of 10, they don't have enough food. All this is happening. And Taliban not noticing that being a leader doesn't just to force people, but also to taking care of well-being of their citizens. And you know, but I have to say that despite of all of these challenges, Afghan women, Afghan girls have shown remarkable resilience in the face of adversity. We see these young women, when they get arrested, get tortured, not even have the family support, they still go to the street and protest it. It still says no.
According to the UN, Afghanistan has become the most repressive country in the world for women and girls. What are the long-term effects on the next generation of Afghan girls for these policies?
I think that what's happening is not only physical harm, but also the
psychological
damage as well. And it's affected on their children because of the mom who is not happy and depressed will affect it on the child how to rise. And it's not only the individual woman, but also impact the nation in whole. the poverty level will gonna go up, and you're never gonna have a peaceful society if you ignore half of the population and minorities. Taliban knows that they can't have a prosperous society and driving the economy if they ignoring half of the population, but also create more restriction for minorities. Yeah. It's just not gonna work.
You have training centers in Herat and Kabul that continue to train students. How do they continue to operate, and what is their current status?
Unfortunately, most of our centers were closed.
Closed by the Taliban?
Yes, closed by Taliban. And because of the rule that the age of the girls after 15, they are not allowed to continue their education. And recently, we were able to open and support the girls' education in Kabul, but it should be under the age of 15. We have more than 350 students there. But we also started to support communities and the underground education, an initiative that the women lead. And we have thousands of students currently studying. And as I mentioned, the women, young women in Afghanistan are resilient. They're going to find a way to educating themselves. And this is not going to be a solution for millions, but I have to assure you that this young generation are different than the generation of the 1996. So Taliban are facing with different mindset.
Did you just say you have hundreds, maybe thousands of women studying underground?
We have around 1,050 students that currently are studying on underground education, and they are all led
by... How do they do that?
So they have usually their homes, and they're bringing 10 to 20 students there. And then they train them about the maths and science, and then you paying the teachers. So that's how the community supported right now. Usually it's happening with the community that the female and the families wants that education for their girls. And it's growing very fast. It's not only us, but the other organization also supporting.
So you're saying the Taliban's best effort to return women to the home and to not being educated are not fully successful.
No, it's not fully successful. I mean, this is happening, and Taliban already know that, so they cannot stop that. And that is what I'm saying, that technology is a tool that we can, oppressive regime can stop it.
What roles are left for women in Afghan society?
We can ask this question from Taliban. Oh, there is a role for women. Being a good mother, but they forgot it. Being a good mother, a mom needs security, a peace of the mind, access to opportunities. So they took everything from you, and then they asked you to be a good mom and staying home. And they also forgot that if the mom doesn't have a husband or a father that will not be at home, how she can protect the children and feeding the children. So they forgot about this part because they don't want to think about that. There are thousands and hundred thousands of the women who are widow, and they don't have any male to support them, and they need these jobs to make money and supporting their children. They didn't think about that.
You met with John Kerry in Kabul when he was Secretary of State, and he went on to cite you as a great Afghan success story. Decades earlier in John Kerry's life, he was an anti-war activist. In 1971, he was on this program, and he made the case that the United States should withdraw from Vietnam. Take a look.
I think we can talk for hours about why we're there and what happened. Mm-hmm. But the question is now, should we get out, and what is really at stake?
No, that's not the question.
The question is, what is at stake?
The question is, what is at stake, exactly.
Exactly. And what is at stake is intimately tied. If nothing is at stake, you get out. And I have said that nothing is at stake.
Kerry argued that Vietnam was no longer a vital U.S. interest. And that's what President Biden argued, that Afghanistan was no longer a vital U.S. interest. How do you respond to that argument?
I think that 20 years of the fight with terrorism and extremists, and after many sacrifices of Americans and as well Afghans for having the democracy, I think that fight was worse. And obviously, I heard President Biden that they are not there for building nations, but we actually was a hope for many of the people around of us when they see that we could talk our truth to the power. And this is inspire so many of the generation and young people in those countries. And I understand that it might not be a fight forever for American, but I think that they could withdraw responsibly. So I can say that.
The U.S. and Taliban officials have recently met for the first time since the fall of the government. The Taliban said they discussed lifting sanctions and returning Afghan assets, and the U.S. officials have voiced concerns over human rights and pressed, supposedly, for the reversal of restrictions on women and girls. Do you see the U.S. engaging in a dialogue about human rights with the Taliban as an encouraging development?
I mean, many Afghans have different perspective on this. I would say that engaging with Taliban in dialogue, it should be continue. But not meeting with the Afghan women's leadership and other people who are disagree with the governments of the political groups, I think is wrong. I mean, it's good that you have meetings in the same time with the women in the same city, that making sure that the Taliban understand that they world didn't forget about the women in Afghanistan.
That the world hasn't forgotten about the women in Afghanistan.
Yes, this is again give them a message that they cannot ignore us, and they cannot put us in oppressive time that there was in 1996.
What is the sentiment amongst Afghans who cooperated with the United States, who then saw the United States leave? What is the feeling about the United States to those who are left in Afghanistan?
I mean, there are many of them are disappointed, and especially those who work for the U.S. government. I think it's a moral obligation for the United States and their allies to take the people who work for them out and give them a chance to leave, because it's the best interest of the United States as well. Because many of these people who work for the government and for the U.S. government in the past, they have skills, they have a knowledge, they can contribute to this society. And I think that is a moral obligation.
You had an extraordinary experience of having a former president of the United States paint a portrait of you. President George W. Bush painted a portrait of you, which he then featured in his book, Out of Many, One. And he said that his portrait of you is among his favorite paintings. What was that experience like for you?
You know, my life has been changed because of President Bush's decision to come to Afghanistan. Lots of the school has been built, road built, hospital built. And we had amazing time, and this has happened because of the one person who had the courage to come all the way and says no to darkness and bring the light. And so for me, always I wanted to meet with President Bush, and I had this honor to meet with him. I have all the respect for Ms. Bush and President Bush for everything that they have done, especially for women empowerment. They have done a lot.
He painted you wearing a headscarf.
Yes. I wear usually a scarf because it's part of my culture. But since, I don't know, since Taliban took over the power, and I feel like a little bit... but I think that I like the scarf because I just want to show that I'm Afghans, and showing that this is a beautiful thing that I have from my culture.
On the one-year anniversary of the fall of Kabul, you tweeted, "Remember, caution and acceptance never change the world. If we do not dare to lead the way and dream of something different, nothing will ever change. Freedom demands sacrifice, bravery, and persistence." Another year has passed since that tweet. How will you ensure the world does not sink in to caution and acceptance?
Because we will not allow it. We will be amplifying the voice of the women. And I think, as I mentioned, it's gonna take time. It's a challenging fight, it's a challenging road, but it's worth it. It's worth it, you know? I had a chance to live in freedom and democracy, and I changed my life. I live in New York, and, you know, I started my business. I'm doing robotics and many of the things. But I think that those generation who left behind in Afghanistan, they're worse too. It's worse to think about them. And giving the things that I have today here, making sure that they have it too. Another thing is, I think that extremists and terrorism are diseases, like diseases. They're like a cancer that caused by poor education, poverty, and not having a government to hearing your voices, and you're living in a world that there is no opportunity. looking at the Taliban soldiers, they never had those chances. They lived in a village, they lived in a dark, they never had access to information outside their world, and they only heard what they have told. So I think that we needed also to thinking that how we create a solution for Afghan people inside of the country. We're talking about millions of young generation that they are very vulnerable. If we forgot about them, there is a huge risk that they can become brainwashed. So that's why we should not left them to in darkness, and making sure that well-being of citizen and having access to information are very important. And we have to do it that to prevent it, a radicalization of this young generation.
Roya Mahboob, thank you for joining me on Firing Line.
Thank you for having me.
Firing Line with Margaret Hoover is made possible in part by Robert Granieri, Vanessa and Henry Cornell, the Fairweather Foundation, the Tepper Foundation, the Asness Family Foundation, the McKenna Family Foundation, Charles R. Schwab, and by the Rosalind P. Walter Foundation, and Damon Button. Corporate funding is provided by Stevens, Inc.
You're watching PBS.